Gamercast Network.
Hey. All right. It's a video game show. It's a video game show. It's not a game show about videos. It's a video game show.
Welcome to the Gamercast Network video game show for Sunday, November 25th, 2007. This is episode 65. I'm Chad. For the roll call this week, when I say your name, describe for me your ultimate sidekick in a game. And joining us this evening is Ivan.
Somebody who actually helps. I'm tired of playing games with crappy AI where sidekicks run out into the open and die or stand directly in front of you while you're trying to shoot. The worst is when you have like friendly fire for your sidekick in a game and they continually just stand in front of you. Much like Bob when I'm crouched in sniper mode and he just stands directly in front of me shooting a rocket.
How's my ass look? This looking good? Right here? Right in your scope. How'd you like this right here? You got a good close-up view of that right there? Yeah, you like that, don't you?
You had steak for lunch, didn't you?
I had steak for breakfast.
Also joining us this evening is Keith.
My sidekick would be a half midget, half polar bear mutant.
Which half is the human half? Because like a midget's legs with, you know, a polar bear upper half would be funny as hell. He'd probably fall down a lot. And then his little legs just keep kicking because, you know, he didn't have the leg strength to pull himself back up.
The upper half would be the human, so he'd be a centaur polar bear.
Yeah. Okay, next on the list is Bob.
I want a little winged gnome who flutters around my shoulders and tells me what exactly stupid thing the devs had in mind for this particular board that I need to do in order to not get killed 30 times in a row. For instance, would be, you get to the board, there's the main boss. So what do? I'm going to shoot him in the face. Oh, unbeknownst to you, you have to kill the four pillars first before he'll take any damage. Of course, I don't know that, but little gnome sidekick winged thing who flaps around my head would be like, hey, looky there, you got to kill the little pillars first. And he would be there for every single game. Same guy. Everyone would never change. I'm going to call him Toledo.
Toledo. Toledo the winged gnome.
Also, joining us this evening is Phil.
My sidekick would probably be a little bit shorter than I am, just so I could slap him around. And he would have to be able to kill things that I couldn't kill. Like, if I was, like, shooting a weapon that was, like, shooting fire, he'd have to shoot, like, ice and kind of counteract what I do. So, like, if there's something that I can't kill, he can kill it, and I don't have to like go back to town every time and get a different weapon.
So you want a squire?
Well, if I needed the sidekick, here, I will describe my sidekick by naming him. I will name him Bullseye, the human target. I want him to be the one that everyone shoots at first, the cannon fodder. So when they're shooting at him, I can go kill their asses with a machine gun.
So when they're shooting at him, they're not shooting at you?
Exactly.
You mean the guy who walks into the room first when everybody's got their tech queued up and hits him simultaneously? Like, he's the one who takes all that? Target lad! I have that guy. He has a red helmet and a bullseye on his chest.
This week on the Gamercast Network. On Gamertag Radio, the staff finally reveals this year's third annual Xbox Community Awards 2007 nominees and an interview with members from Gamer Chicks about women in gaming. Achievement Junkie is now being recorded from a secret cave somewhere in Redmond, Washington, where they'll give you the scoop on the 360 and reveal your thoughts on including sex in video games. Check out Podtacular for the latest news from the unofficial Halo universe. Discover the website that brings you all of these great episodes and headlines at GamercastNetwork.com. That's GamercastNetwork.com.
Next topic.
Okay, so Mass Effect came out last week for the Xbox 360, and Ivan and Keith here have both played the game. First off, what does it play like? Describe it in terms of another game.
All right, I would say it's a first-person shooter, Knights of the Old Republic. If you just pretty much take Knights of the Old Republic and kind of turn it into a shooter, I mean, it's that kind of a game. It's a good role-playing game. I like BioWare's role-playing games.
So it's a sci-fi game. Does the story feel very epic?
Oh, yeah.
The story is very, very well done. They had a good approach to making your guy. You basically choose your background. Were you a war hero? Were you, like, you know, a sole survivor of something? You know, were you born on Earth? You pick your whole guy, so all the storyline and plot discussions based around that. And then when you talk, it's just kind of like you pick an attitude more than what you're exactly going to say. And then it plays out like a little movie.
One of the things with a lot of role-playing games, especially the BioWare ones, is that you can either be good or bad. You know, like in Knights of the Old Republic, when you did something bad, you became more of a dark Jedi. Yet when you did something good, you became more of a light Jedi. You kind of swung yourself back. Now in Mass Effect, when you do the actions, do they swing you back from bad to good, or are they more independent?
They're independent scales. So you can answer two things like a nice guy and one thing like a jerk. You're not more of a good guy than a bad guy.
Okay, so you can talk as a jerk. Now, can you act like a jerk and start killing people?
Yeah. One scene where there's this alien race that has slaughtered people, and you find this queen alien thing. It convinces you that there's a bad group of kids. They didn't learn the things that their race has supposedly taught their children for centuries. This queen convinces you that this batch of aliens are bad and they need to be exterminated, but, you know, essentially they're a good race at heart. So one of the things that you can do
is slaughter them?
Yes. You have to slaughter them regardless. But one of the choices you have is either slaughter this queen thing to prevent this race from ever reproducing again, or you can let it go being convinced that they really are going to be nice. It's weird, though. I went into this thinking I'm going to be a jerk. You can also put points into an intimidate
evil
skill. Yeah, essentially an intimidate skill, which opens up additional options in your dialogue wheel. When you're asking somebody a question and they're not answering you right, instead of trying to get the information out of them, you can essentially say, tell me what I want to know, or I'm going to shoot you in the face. You know, that opens up those kinds of things. But, you know
that very persuasive argument.
Yeah.
You get a lot of answers that way, you really do.
I went into it thinking I'm going to be just this total badass jerk guy. You know, I've found myself in the dialogue wheel going, you know what, I kind of wussed out. I'm like, I don't really want to answer it that way. That's the cool thing with this, though. I remember playing Jedi Knight, maybe the second one, where you can be literally either a good Jedi or a bad Jedi, depending on, like, if you slaughter everything in your path, you keep constantly going to the dark side. And I played that game just being a total jackhole. I slaughtered every droid that came my way, every human that I could hit with a lightsaber I would.
Can I hit you? No, damn. Can I hit you? No, damn.
This game is a lot more in depth. You know, it's not just a matter of whip out your lightsaber and do you shoot this thing or not. No, now you got to start talking to these people, and definitely mature rated things. You have to save a exotic dancer who's actually undercover. It gives you a lot of choices. It's a lot of fun. If you want to be one thing or the other, you don't have to keep doing one thing in order to achieve that. You know, you can be intimidating when you answer questions, but, you know, there's that little soft spot inside the bad guy where when a queen alien begs you for its life, you can let it go.
One thing I found hard to do in these games is if you start out the game playing one way, like you were doing, like, all right, I'm just going to be a total jackass and all this nonsense. But then, like, halfway through the game, like, try to play a character that's trying to redeem himself, the Dark Paladin thing, where, like, all right, I'm going to make amends. It's like, usually once you got that evil slider to the side, like, no one will let you act another way.
Doesn't seem like that, Bob. When I've been a dick to some people, it still seems like you get all of the available options later on. If you have to talk to one guy a couple of times and you're an ass to him the first time, you still get the good dialogue options.
Yeah, like if you want to do something like, I don't know, not say the exact answer because you don't know she's undercover and been like, you know, you're a whore. I'm just going to let you die. And then you find out later that, like, you know, she survived and ends up she was undercover and all this crap. Like, can you apologize? Be like, ends up you're not a whore. My bad. this is a bit awkward, but... You doing all right? Yeah.
If it makes you feel any better, you're very convincing as a whore, because I believed you.
So, sum it up. Would the vast majority of 360 players out there like this game?
I mean, it's a role-playing game. If you liked Oblivion, how in-depth it was, you'll like this. Somebody like Chris, though, would hate it. I played 5 or 6 hours and probably had 3 or 4 decent battles. He never even would have made it that far. He would have played it for 2 hours, had one battle, and said, F this.
Not enough shooting in the face for Chris.
Next topic.
Anything else there you want to cover on Mass Effect?
The combat. The first part of the game, there's not a whole lot of it. But there are times when you blow through whole sections of combat where you have to kill a couple of guys and you shoot them twice and they're dead. And then there's whole sections. There was one boss that literally took me probably 50 tries. And it got so bad that I said, you know what, screw this. I'm playing the game on normal difficulty. I bumped the difficulty down to easy just to beat this boss. Because if I didn't, I would stop the game there and never play it again.
Now hang on, do you think you could have beaten him if you were to grind and level up yourself like 5 or 10 more levels?
Absolutely. You know, I got to a point where I'm like, screw this. How do you beat? There's got to be, it's like Bob said, I needed the damn flying.
You need Toledo to help you out.
Felt like I was doing it right. I just wasn't powerful enough or something.
Doing it hard enough.
Yeah.
Wasn't doing it hard enough. I needed to do it harder. You know, everything I saw was people saying, oh, you know, when I did it, I was level 35 or I was level 32 and here I am, you know, level 20 or 22 or something like that. I'm very convinced that, yes, if I were to have gone and done a bunch of other side missions and leveled up some more, it probably would have been easier.
You know, there's been a couple role-playing games like that. You know, you go through all the levels and you're at like 20 and you're fine. And you hit this one point where, oh no, to beat this guy, you have to be 45. And then you have to go back and grind. I remember I never beat Final Fantasy VIII at the end because I wasn't high enough. And I got stuck in that one zone. I couldn't get out. I couldn't go grind anymore. So I kind of like threw up my hands and said, I don't want to play anymore.
Ay, caramba!
That was one of the bad things people said about Oblivion was, like, every enemy that you encounter is ranged to your character's level. So you could do one mission at level 10, and the character is, you know, level 15. And if you go back and you do it and you're level 40, the guy's level 45 or whatever, you know.
I did that in Oblivion where the first series of quests I did, the very, very first series of quests, was the arena. So I won the arena, and then it's talking about how they're going to go gather the fiercest, most death-defying monsters in the realm, and I fought a wolf. So, like, I killed the great gladiator, and, you know, I'm hailed as the arena champion and the greatest fighter and this, that, and the other thing, and I fight a goblin and his wolf.
That's a good example, because I know I did that quest, and when I did it much later. I fought the three freaking Minotaur lords.
Actually, that whole dynamic scaling system, they're tweaking that for Fallout 3. If they hold to their current system, when you enter a zone, it locks the zone at that scale level right there. Say you're level 10, you go in, okay, they're all level 15. They're too strong for you. Okay, so you leave, and then you go a level and come back. Those guys are still level 15. You might be level 20. It's not going to scale up.
That's good, because one of the biggest complaints I have about a lot of these games is if, you know, you go too far ahead or something and don't do enough of the side quests or something, the main quests get ultra hard really, really, really fast. You want non-linear gameplay, but you kind of have to do the stuff in order or else you're not high enough to go past it, and that kind of makes it linear in a sense. That sounds a lot better. That sounds like something where you'd play the quest however and there'll be the proper difficulty and you can come back to them whenever. I like that a lot.
Next topic.
Okay, let's move on. Let's move on to the game announcements that came up this last week. One big announcement is that Blood Bowl is coming to the Xbox Live Arcade, PlayStation Portable, and Nintendo DS.
That's going to be the bee's knees.
So, Blood Bowl. Why should the kids care about this, what is this, 15, 20-year-old game?
Basically like a strategy football game with no rules. You can viably have a team just beat the other team up enough so that you win. You know, your secret weapons are like chainsaws and poison daggers, and you can buy off refs. It's just a very, like, you know, over-the-top, very violent football game. I always made the chaos team, and I could never catch or throw the ball. My whole game plan was to hurt enough of their players so that they couldn't stop me from just picking up the ball and running with it, because I would normally fail to pick it up.
Okay, so the second big announcement last week was, I guess, there isn't much to this other than the fact that it's coming, is there's going to be a Rainbow Six Vegas 2. Now, I'm pretty sure that's not the final name. It'll probably be changed.
Dude, why don't they change a name from Rainbow to anything else?
Yeah, really. Anything. Please.
So you guys here played a lot of Rainbow Six Vegas. What would you like to see them change for the next iteration of the game?
The leveling. Oh my god. That was a mess. I mean, it's a good idea, but god, you had to play so much.
So leveling, you mean you had to like kill so many guys to get experience points and get bonuses and perks and weapons?
Little stuff, like what your armor looked like and everything else. A lot of it was mostly cosmetic. The armor helped, I'm sure.
Well, some of the armor helped, yeah, some of the guns helped, but it's not like if you were level 50 and you had stuff that you were at that much of an advantage from somebody.
Exactly.
Lower. It was mostly cosmetic.
Only
other complaint that I really had about the game was the sharpshooterness of the guys in the Terrorist Hunt. We tried Terrorist Hunt as soon as we got the game and just found it almost nearly impossible. It was one of these things where, like, they're a pixel tall on the screen and they see you, but I mean, we're humans. It's only a pixel. I'm not sure if that's a plant or a guy, you know?
The other thing, I understand why they're doing this. They're probably reusing a lot of the same maps and terrain and stuff. Unfortunately, I would like to see a different setting. Vegas was cool and all, but
it's too damn shiny.
Like Ghost Recon for the PC, where it was more outside and bigger instead of so tight and confined.
I think that's the point of Rainbow Six, though, is Rainbow Six is their
Well, that's why I don't want quarter. Rainbow anything.
You want another Ghost Recon Advance Warfighter. GRAW is essentially Rainbow Six, but in open areas. Rainbow Six was always meant to be the close quarter terrorist hunt kind of thing.
Okay, so unfortunately, if you're stuck to close quarter combat, where would you like to see it placed in what city or what environment?
Oh, that's a good question.
London, 2012.
Next topic.
Jeff Minter is the one who made Space Giraffe, the Xbox Live arcade game, which Ivan likes so fondly. He was not very happy because apparently the sales of Space Giraffe were not very good. Here is his quote. Jesus Christ. Not seeing a lot of reason to continue even trying to make games at this point when a remake of Frogger, one of the worst games in the history of old arcade games, can outsell Space Giraffe that we put so much love and effort into by more than 10 to 1 in a week. Okay, we get the message. All you want on that channel is remakes of old arcade games and crap you vaguely remember playing on your Amiga. We'll shut up trying to do anything new then. Sorry for even trying.
Well, I accept your apology.
Yeah. Maybe it's not so much that you spent a lot of time and effort and love to create.
More that you used the Lord's name in vain.
Or maybe it's the fact that the game you created was essentially an acid-tripping, hippie, colorful explosion of donkey vomit all on one screen at the same time, and no clear idea of what the hell you were actually supposed to do. I swear, if you smoke weed or you do acid, this is the game for you. Jeff Minter's the developer from the 70s, talking about old arcade games, wanting to make a new old arcade game, and it coming out being one big acid trip. I bet you this guy wears Birkenstocks with socks, shorts, and a t-shirt that says, you know, weed for all or something like that.
Legalize it.
Yeah.
Dude, it's called Space Giraffe. That doesn't seem weird to anybody else. Just
and there's not even any giraffes in the game.
Well, hang on. Maybe that's the problem, Ivan. Maybe we weren't playing it while high. If we had been, maybe we would see the giraffe.
Maybe. You know, all I can say to Mr. Minter is look at all the other new original arcade games that have come out for at least the 360 that have been selling well.
One concession I will give him is I too have no idea why people are choosing to play Frogger on purpose now when there's other things. Any other thing.
Okay, so he does have one valid point in that.
Frogger does suck. Yes, I'll give him that.
Here's a great point. Geometry Wars is essentially kind of a take on Berserk, where you're a thing and you constantly shoot in all different directions while things swarm you. Kind of like how Space Giraffe is kind of like Tempest, only not. So it's not really a remake. It's kind of a re-imaging. And Geometry Wars has sold millions of copies. It's not that we don't want people like Jeff Minter to come up with new ideas or new takes on old games or fresh new games. It's that we don't want Santa Claus barfing up his Christmas tree lights onto the screen and then have to smoke acid while playing it.
You don't smoke acid.
Next topic.
Last week I had actually done a small review of Crysis, the PC game. I nixed it because I heard that the gameplay changes radically in the second half of the game. So I said, you know what, before I put the review out, I probably should play the second half of the game. Crysis is, of course, the new game that has come out, which all of the uber graphics. And gameplay-wise, first half of the game plays like Far Cry. And Far Cry, for those who don't know, was a very open-ended first-person shooter where you're set on an island. You can do your goal anyway. Crysis kind of takes to the next level. And if I had to compare the first half of the game to anything, I would say it's Far Cry plus Crackdown. Because in Crackdown, you have all those abilities. You can jump far, punch hard. So in Crysis, you have a suit that can grant you those kind of abilities as well. Then you play the second half of the game.
Is this like From Dusk Till Dawn, where the first half of the movie is about a bank heist, and the second half of the movie is about fighting vampires?
Yes, actually, you know what? You know what, Ivan? You're practically right on right there. You're no longer fighting humans.
You hit on the perfect analogy.
That is the perfect analogy. The whole game changes. And actually, it goes from being an open-ended first-person shooter to more linear, more like a Half-Life kind of game. Not that it's bad, it's just, if someone's coming to this game expecting Far Cry throughout, it changes.
Does it feel rushed? Like, holy crap, we only have a year left to get this game done, so...
No, I don't think it was that, because actually the second half of the game shows off, they have some really, really cool things they did in the second half of the game that I would have loved to have seen more of, just in more of an open environment. Okay, for example, it's not a spoiler. In the second half of the game, you fight in zero-G combat.
You have no gold.
You have no gold.
It's really hard to buy ammo.
Okay, zero gravity combat. Had they done more things like that in less linear environment, the second half would have been so much more enjoyable. I love the first half of the game. The second half of the game, it was okay. It just wasn't anything spectacular. If you came to this game expecting Far Cry just evolved, you should really expect Far Cry evolved plus Half-Life evolved. I enjoyed it. It's not God's greatest gift to everything. So there's Crysis in a nutshell. I'm sure I'll get flamed for something I said there, but...
It's your opinion, man.
Next topic.
And I want to throw one complaint to all developers out there. Now, I know Crysis is all about the graphics. I have one of the 8800 GTs, one of the new cards, which is a very good performing card at a very low cost, $250, and it can hang with a $500 card. And when I first started up the game, everything ran smooth as silk. Please, developers, from now on, when you make a game like this, have early on the game, or have some kind of benchmark utility that will push the graphics card as hard at that point in the game as it will throughout the rest of the game.
Oh, so like when you get to the big boss that's covered in tentacles or something, your frame rate doesn't die and then you lose and then it's very frustrating and no one's happy?
Yes. You know, when you first start the game up, it says choose your graphics settings and it'll scan for you. So you push the auto detect button and it says, oh, you can run on high mode. If you told me that, I expect the game to run at 30 to 40 frames per second constantly.
I've heard when they auto pick settings, they choose for it heaviest part of the game, you get 12 to 15. That's why anytime I usually auto detect settings and then go in and reduce everything by like 25%.
Here's why this was a problem. Because at like level 3 or 4, you're part of this whole massive assault on this harbor base. As soon as you get in the zone, planes are flying overhead, dropping bombs, planes are crashing. All these great events are going off because it's all rendered in real time, except real time has now become 10 frames a second.
I was going to say, I'm going to bet it really wasn't rendered in real time.
I would have loved to have known that that was going to happen beforehand so I could have tweaked my settings down.
So it should give you a warning. Frame rate about to be
it should be like...
Save
like
your good, game now.
It should be like good MP3 players where it auto-levels the song for you. So
exactly.
You're not listening to the song and then halfway through it gets so high that it makes your ears bleed. It should do that with the graphics.
What really they should do is when they're saying auto-detect settings, they should give you an option for what you want your frame rate to be. It's like, what would you like your average frame rate to be? And I would type in 40. And they're like, all right, here's your crappy settings then. And I was like, thank you very much, as long as the frame rate doesn't drop.
I don't want to have to start playing into a zone, realize, oh, I gotta go switch to setting number 2, go flip the settings, reload, then play through it. That breaks it.
Yeah, that really, it takes you out of the game. It really does.
For me, being immersed in a game means having a good, solid frame rate of around 30, 40 frames a second.
Yes, me too. Amen.
Next topic.
Do you like murder?
Murder's fun, only if it's Murder 1.
This could be Murder 1. This is in Vietnam. Hanoi, Vietnam. There was a 13-year-old boy who was arrested. He was accused of murdering and robbing an 81-year-old woman.
That's not nice.
Why did he do this? Well, apparently he's an MMO player. He needed money to play some of his MMO. So he got a piece of rope, strangled her, and took 100,000 dong.
And that's a lot of dong!
I don't think you'd be looking for that much dong from an old woman, you know? I mean, there's...
Now, how much is 100,000 dong in American money?
$6.50.
Yeah, it's about $6.50.
Really?
You're kidding me. I honest to God, I totally made that number up. I'm awesome. I know my dong.
You are a man who knows his dong.
So there you go. And to kick off the bright holiday season, killing old women for their dong.
I'm not even going to humor this with comments of... dongs.
I was going to say here real quick, this is not something new in Vietnam. Apparently something like this happened about 6-7 months ago. There was a young boy, a 15-year-old, who also wanted some money to play an MMO. However, instead of killing someone, he was trying to extort money by kidnapping a businessman's daughter and then holding her for ransom. And his threat was if the businessman did not pay, he would throw sulfuric acid in the daughter's face.
Well, that's nice.
Oh, wow. Huh. He couldn't just, I don't know, send him a pinky? I guess those days of hostaging are over.
This is new school.
This is the new age hostage. Are you going to cut off my pinky now? No, we're just going to dump sulfuric acid on you. You should have paid.
Next topic.
Do you want to do a fact or crap? I have one. This is four craps and one fact. Now, as usual, you guys here have to pick out which one is fact from the crap. Okay, number one. There was an Atari 2600 game based on the film The Texas Chainsaw Massacre. Now, in this game, when you played as the role of Sally, who was the girl from the movie, and you had to avoid the whole family of cannibals. Number two. Lots of shows ago, we talked about a game called Hero Quest. It was a board game, which was set in the Warhammer universe. To that board game, there was a sister board game called Space Crusade, which was set in the Warhammer 40,000 universe. A company called Graphic Gremlins made a PC version of Space Crusade. However, it was not a very successful game at all. It came out, it tanked, and there were no sequels or expansions. Number three, I looked up the top grossing video game movies of all time. The number one film is Lara Croft Tomb Raider. The number two film is the first Pokemon movie. Number four, Konami wants to release more and more health and fitness games on the Nintendo DS. The Japanese market is really hungering for these non-game games. And what we got here is Konami, their first game in this whole new brand, is going to be a jogging game. You're going to plug in the Game Boy Advance slot, a pedometer thing that measures, you know, how far you've walked or ran. And then you got to carry your DS as you walk or jog or whatever. It monitors your stuff and tells you if you're doing good or not. And finally, number five, Wonderland. We always say that Second Life is this bastion of porn and gambling and all that kind of crap. Some guys actually made a very nice thing. Someone actually took the time to make an island based on Lewis Carroll's Alice in Wonderland. So you can go there, have your little tea and crumpets with the Mad Hatter. So there you go. Four of those are crap. One is fact. So which one of those is real? Let's start with Ivan. Which one is fact?
Let's see. Number one, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I remember a Friday the 13th game where you had to avoid Jason.
Whatever.
I don't remember Texas Chainsaw, though. Hero Quest, I don't know anything about. Therefore, it must not have existed. Number three, I don't know how well Tomb Raider did. I gotta believe that something else was number two ahead of Pokemon. And finally, the Wonderland thing. I don't think anyone would spend that much time devoting something that wouldn't make them money by selling pornography.
Porn.
Yeah, in that video game. So I'm going to go with number four because I believe the Japanese are insane enough and they love their DSs. There was some obnoxious number like 2/3 of every human in Japan owns a DS or something like that. They love them some weird-ass peripherals. So I would easily believe that there is a pedometer that would plug into your DS since you're carrying it around with you all day long anyway. So I'm going to go with number four.
Okay, Bob, what do you think?
Let's see. Well, the Wonderland thing is obviously not real because it's Second Life and everything is porn. The DS jogging game, I'm going to say, is a piece of crap because where the hell in the middle of Tokyo are you going to jog? I would very much say that Tomb Raider was probably the highest grossing video game movie. So I'm going to go with number three as fact.
Keith?
I'm going to go with Space Crusade because I like Warhammer.
And finally, Phil.
I'll pick number two, the Space Crusade game.
Okay, and the one that is real is Tomb Raider was indeed the number one video game movie of all time.
Hell yes. Bring it.
Pokemon was number two. Space Crusade did come out for the PC. However, it did not tank. It actually was very popular, and there was a sequel to it. There was a Texas Chainsaw Massacre game for the Atari 2600. However, you did not play as Sally. You played as Leatherface.
Really?
Wow, I didn't even think there was a Texas Chainsaw Massacre game.
Yeah, the game was you had to go around, hack down your victims while avoiding fences, wheelchairs, and cow skulls.
Wheelchairs.
The handicapped victims are actually the mightiest ones.
The jogging game. Now, there might actually be a jogging game coming out from somebody, but Konami is not making any jogging games. They have announced they are making three games that are health fitness games. They are making a skincare game.
Oh, God.
They are making a yoga game and a game for the Pilates.
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 And finally, the Wonderland of...
It's all porn, isn't it?
Wonderland is a zone filled with avatars that look like 10-year-old girls.
Mm-hmm. Oh.
Ugh.
The girls just go around and do what you would think they would do in Second Life, so...
Right, so it's
Why
pedophilia
don't they shut
land,
that down?
Not
My
Wonderland.
God.
It's just people talking, so technically nothing bad is going on. I mean, you can't control what people say, so...
It'd be like trying to shut down a chat room because people are trying to pick up 10-year-olds.
Well, the reason they don't shut this down is even though the girls look like 10-year-olds, according to Linden Labs, they're all of legal age. Yeah, right, so who knows?
Whatever.
God, what a depraved video game. And my preferred genre is one where you kill humans, so that's saying a lot.
Next topic.
Did anybody do anything for Black Friday?
I didn't go to the store.
Yeah.
It was nice.
At least Bebop and Phil played Hellgate pretty much all day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dude, did you see, like, the pictures on TV of, like, people lined up at the mall and all that nonsense and waiting outside at 5 a.m.? And what would happen to me and why I don't do this is because I would just, like, walk casually in and just hit whoever tried to take the last one of the thing I was going to buy and just be like, well, you should have been stronger, and then just walk to the checkout and leave because who the hell's going to, like, stop you? It's such a madhouse. In avoidance of hitting people, I stayed home.
I always wondered one thing. Even though they call it Black Friday, I always thought the whole spirit of the thing was to go buy gifts for other people for, you know, Christmas and whatnot.
Oh, people don't do that. People, if you do, you get like, you know, I bought you this thing that I also got myself.
Yeah, yeah. I can't see myself going at 5 in the morning just to get, or trying to get a good deal on 5 of the LCDs they have for 1/3 the cost. It just doesn't make any sense.
I know Fred likes to just go to look. He doesn't even buy things.
That would be awesome. Fred's big self just, I'm going to get in the way. That's what I'm going to do. I'm here to get in the way. I'm going to stand right in front of the thing I want, look like I'm going to pick it up, and I'm so big that you're not going to take it, and then I'm just going to walk away.
Oh, look. Look at the last Tickle Me Elmo. I think I'm going to pick this up and read the box for 20 minutes. You want to go ahead and try and take that from me, Grandma? Go ahead.
Because I'm not done. Like, I love it. Bravo. Ham sandwich Fred for getting in the way.
Why don't you get your ass back in your soccer mom minivan and drive down to Target, because
I'll
let
you know when I'm done. I'll give you a ring. Want to leave your cell phone number? I'll let you know when I'm done looking, because right now, not so much.
That was Video Game Show episode number 65 for Sunday, November 25th, 2007. Any share dream pies or ham sandwiches to the world?
Ham sandwich to the Cleveland Browns. 7-4.
Yeah, they're not going to be dead last. That's the Dolphins.
I'm going to give a ham sandwich to the guy that did not turn off my gas line last night. My house is warm. I'm happy.
And as usual, send your comments, questions, queries, or concerns to the mailbag at mailbag@videogameshow.org, Skype us at videogameshow, or call us at 320-300-GAME. That is a standard long-distance call, and all normal fees apply. And that's a wrap. Good night.
Bob just dropped.
Sorry. It was one of those things where it died and then started repeating the last thing Ivan said. It's like, and one of those things where you can level, 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 you can level. I was like, I'm pretty sure he's not saying that.
He really wanted to make sure that you knew that you could level.
Really just hammering that home.